Oh, that's what I meant to do.
Two, one, two. Good morning, everybody, and you're all very welcome to our church as members of a congregation, and also welcome to all of you who are viewing our Mass online. As you know, today is Palm Sunday, and we begin what we call the great celebration of Holy Week. And the highlight of Holy Week is the final 3 days, what we call the Easter Triduum, in which we celebrate the Passion, Death, and Resurrection of Christ. However, the day's Mass is also dominated by the reading of the Passion, which is from Mark's Gospel. But we begin our celebration of Mass by blessing the palms and reading the passage of Mark's Gospel, which describes Jesus' triumphant journey into Jerusalem. Dear sisters and brothers, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's Paschal Mystery, that is to say, of his Passion and Resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that by being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. So if you have palms, you may hold them up, please. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When they were approaching Jerusalem in the sight of Bethpage and Bethany, close by the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go off to the village facing you, and as soon as you enter it, you will find a tattered colt that no one has yet ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone says to you, 'What are you doing?' say, 'The master needs it, and will send it back here directly.' They went off and found a colt, tethered near a door in the open street. As they untied it, some men standing there said, 'What are you doing, untying that colt?' They gave the answer Jesus had told them, and the men let them go. Then they took the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on his back, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, others greenery which they had cut in the fields. And those who went in front and those who followed were all shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessings on him who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessings on the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heavens. The Gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. And in our Mass today, we remember the following for whom we offer this Mass: for Austin Quinn of Ardrum, for Jerry Brady of Ardark, for Michael and Maureen O'Hara of Ardrum, and for Phil and Lily McGovern Tully. We pause for a moment as we remember them and pray for them. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. So now we be seated as we listen to God's word.
First reading, a reading from the prophet Isaiah. I did not cover my face against insult. I know I shall not be shamed. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I may be untouched by the insults. So, too, I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial Psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord. Let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend. Response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet. I can count every one of my bones. Response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me. Response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise, all sons of Jacob. Give him glory. Revere him, Israel's son. Response?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Second reading, a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. He humbled himself, but God raised him high. His state was divine, yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel acclamation. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ was humbler yet, even to accepting death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all names. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory.
For the reading of the Passion, we'd ask you please to be seated. And as there are two other readers along with me, we also ask you where you see the bold print, namely where you see C for the crowd, to come in answers, to join with the reader in answering that where you see the C.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, and the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death, for they said,
It must not be during the festivities, or there will be a disturbance among the people.
Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly,
"Why this waste of ointment? Ointment like this could have been sold for over 3 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
"Leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What she has done for me is one of the good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what was in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for his burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout all the world the good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her."
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money, and he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of Unleavened Bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and you will meet a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him, and say to the owner of the house, which he enters, 'The master says, where is my dining room, in which I can eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, furnished with couches, all prepared. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12, and while they were at table eating, Jesus said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me. One of you eating with me."
They were distressed and asked him, one after another,
"Not I, surely."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping into the same dish with me. Yes, the Son of Man is going to his fate, as the Scripture says he will. But alas, for the man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born.
And as they were eating, he took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it. And he said to them,
"This is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith, for the scripture says, 'I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said,
"Even if all lose faith, I will not."
And Jesus said to him,
"I tell you solemnly, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times."
But he repeated still more earnestly,
"If I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I pray."
Then he took Peter and James and John with him, and a sudden fear came over him and great distress, and he said to them,
"Oh, my soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake."
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, this hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me, but let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Have you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake. Pray not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take your rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already."
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge, and see he is well guarded when you lead him away."
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
"Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. But this is to fulfill the scriptures."
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Several, indeed, brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him.
"We heard him say, 'I am going to destroy this temple, make my human hands in 3 days, build another not made by human hands.'"
But even on this point, their evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus.
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?"
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him.
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am, And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with clouds of heaven.
The high priest tore his robes and said,
What need of witnesses have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?
And they all gave their verdict. He deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting,
Play the prophet.
And the attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there, stared at him, and said,
You too were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth.
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know. I do not understand what you are talking about.
And he went out into the forecourt. The servant girl saw him and again started telling the bystanders,
This fellow is one of them.
But he again denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter,
You are one of them for sure. Why are you a Galilean?
But he started calling curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man you speak of.
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time. And Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times. And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priests, together with the elders and scribes, in short, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him.
Are you the king of the Jews?
He answered.
It is you who say it.
And the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again.
Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations they are bringing against you.
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now a man called Barabbas was then in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate the customary favor, Pilate answered them,
What do you want to release for you, the king of the Jews?
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. The chief priests, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again.
But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call king of the Jews?
They shouted back.
Crucify him.
Pilate asked them.
Why? What harm has he done?
But they shouted all the louder.
Crucify him.
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner part of the palace, that is, the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown, and put it on him. And they began saluting him.
Hail, King of the Jews!
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him, and they went down on their knees to do him homage. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They led him out to crucify him. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country, to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, The King of the Jews. And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
Aha, so you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Save yourself. Come down from the cross.
The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, for us to see it and believe.
Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Eli! Eli! Lama sabachthani.
This means, my God, why have you deserted me? When some of those who stood by heard this, they said,
Listen, he is calling on Elijah.
Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying,
Wait and see if Elijah will come to take him down.
But Jesus gave out a loud cry and breathed his last breath. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The centurion who was standing in front of him had seen how he had died, and he said,
In truth, this man was a son of God.
Just one point. I heard this morning, I was listening to a sermon, and the question that was asked, in truth, this man was the Son of God. Can I say that about Jesus? Can we acknowledge him as the Son of God and our Savior? Please stand as you profess your faith. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he crucified on the Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. In one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, look forward to the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us place our needs, the needs of the Church and the world, before the Lord, remembering particularly those who suffer and share in the cross of Jesus Christ. As we begin Holy Week, we pray that all Christians may be strengthened and renewed through the celebration of the gracious love of Jesus in his passion, death, and resurrection. Lord, hear us. We pray for women and men throughout the world who will be baptized this Easter. May the Lord be with them and with those who journey with them in these final days of preparation. We also remember all our young boys and girls who are preparing for First Holy Communion. Lord, hear us. We pray for peace, remembering in particular the people of Ukraine and the Holy Land. May war and conflict be replaced by peace, justice, freedom, and respect for our human dignity. Lord, hear us. As you know, if you look at the troch, your trochra box for this Lent, there's a little girl on the front of it called Melita. So we pray for Melita, her family, and the people of Malawi, and all affected by climate change, by drought and floods, that with the work of Throkra and our support, their lives may be changed through justice, love and peace. Lord, hear us. We pray for all who are sick. We remember again little Margaret and all from our parish community who are sick at this time, and all that we know who've experienced surgery or sickness during the week. May they experience the healing hand of God and be comforted by the care and support of those who care for them and who surround them. Lord, hear us. We pray for all in need, for those who suffer through violence, poverty, homelessness, and natural disasters. May we be generous to all in need through our words and deeds of peace and justice. Lord, hear us. For a quiet moment, we remember now our own particular needs, our intentions, as we bring them before the Lord. Lord, hear us. We pray for the faithful departed. We remember especially today the following for whom we remember in this Mass: for Austin Quinn, for Jerry Brady, Michael and Maureen O'Hara, Phil and Lily McGovern, and all the deceased. We pray, Lord, that through your mercy, they may enjoy the fullness of life with you, Jesus our Saviour, Mary our Mother, and all the saints in heaven. Lord, hear us. Good and gracious God, as we follow the way of the cross with Jesus, your Son, this week, grant us the courage to persevere amid the trials of this life and receive the reward of sharing in his risen life, who lives and reigns forever and ever. So will you please be seated. I just might be kind enough to pass around the baskets, and the First Communion children will bring forward the gifts of bread and wine. To share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that the sacrifice that we offer today may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice, made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Please kneel for Eucharistic prayer number 2. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, our God, and profess your resurrection
until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Martin our Bishop, with all the clergy, religious, and your faithful people everywhere. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, especially those we now wish to remember and pray for. Welcome Austin Quinn, Jerry Brady, Michael and Maureen O'Hara, Phil and Lily McGovern, and all the departed into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, with Saints Patrick and Bridget, and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. So invite you please to stand. And at the Saviour's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant us peace in our days. In your mercy, keep us free from sin. Protect us from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. For a quiet moment, we welcome the peace of the Lord into our lives, and we pray for peace throughout our world. May this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to all of us who receive it. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, with faith in your love and mercy, we eat your body and we drink your blood. Let not bring us judgment and condemnation, but through your love and mercy and protection, be for me healing in body and soul. This is Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those that are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call. We make this our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. And just before our final blessing, just to remind you, first of all, that we have penitential service this evening at 6 p.m. with a number of visiting priests. So I hope as many of you as possible will be able to join us for that. That's 6 p.m. here, and it's 7:30 p.m. in Ballyconnell. And the whole list of the program for Holy Week and Easter is in the back of the bulletin. Also, we would be grateful if you would bring in your troker contributions during the ceremonies this coming weekend, because the troker people are always anxious to get the collection of money into the place as soon as possible, because there's a great need for it. Secondly, Exploring the Mass was presented by Bishop Martin and the Kilmore Faith Development Team during Lent. Now, if you didn't get an opportunity to tune into that, you can access it, the various videos, by opening the link that's here on the bulletin. Also is that during the week, we invite you to come to avail of the various ceremonies as much as you can. But also on Friday in the evening, it's not listed in the program, but we will have prayer around the cross here on Friday evening at 8:30. Now, it's just a prayer, a kind of an informal prayer around the cross, which was initiated at Thésée in France with an ecumenical shrine, and is particularly attractive to young people. It's quite informal, but it's a way in which people gather together to pray. There's some of the prayer is led, much of it is informal, and perhaps as a preparation for that, we all carry around with us our various worries and so on. So it has been suggested perhaps that you might pick up a little stone, maybe represents your cross at this time in life, and keep that for the rest of the week. And on the Friday evening here at 8:30, if you come to the church, you leave your stone at the foot of the cross. It's a symbolic thing of being able to let go of that worry that's in your life at this time. Thanks to all who took part in our liturgy today, and particularly to our choir and our readers. The Lord be with you all. And may Almighty God now bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Our Mass now is ended. We go in peace to glorify the Lord with our lives. Thanks be to God.